Okay, so thanks so much to our three presenters. The floor is now open. If there are immediate questions for Andy, please do chime in. Otherwise, we're going to start looking for comments, perhaps that might be more integrative questions, comments people have.
Yeah, I just had a general comment. Over the holidays, I read a book by Thomas Friedman on called Thank You for Being Late, where he gets to discussing how data is used now, say, is shifting careers, but related to even lab economics and building maintenance, where you'll have janitors going around with, and you have to monitor things. So data is coming in all forms. It's a very good book. Kind of related to exactly what you're talking about.
Well, it's interesting just to see how data becomes ubiquitous to all professions. And really how, and there are some really interesting challenges and really profound ones even right now. I think the city of Vancouver wants to go do a zoning in high technology. I think they're changing by 4 zoning or something. And then of course, that how does it define high technology? And the fact of the matter is that you take a look at something like Uber and, Uber, my personal favorite, Airbnb. They're considered not high tech companies, considered transportation and hospitality. And how does that category work in that type of connection, in making sure that there's a permeability in understanding what and where data and technology fit in towards a contemporary economy?
More follow-ups on that? I think we might come back to what it means to be late and whether there are benefits when it comes to data and some of the learning that needs to go in. I think there was a question a couple of the back there and then one in the middle here.
I think for all three speakers, I'm interested in interesting examples of where newly available data sets, perhaps through social media or other means, have been used by city planning departments or others in the urban field for interesting purposes that we may not be thinking about, that we should be looking forward to. These are now available, and what can we do with it, or how can we combine these with other more traditional data sets?
Can you repeat that again, the social media data?
Yeah, the big data that's now available to us, if they're Web 2.0 type data, or things that are coming through social media, Twitter-based data, Facebook-based data, and actual use cases of where what you've seen where it's really interesting that, say, a planning agency or another governmental agency has taken that information, combined it with traditional data, and made new insights.
I can speak from mine. What I see is we started to, because City of Vancouver have a Twitter account and all that, so we started to look at the conversations that are happening on like Twitter and Facebook and see what citizens are interested about. And I get emails sometimes and say, okay, what are the hot topic right now, the trend, what are people concerned about, so that we can facilitate some of the discussion, perhaps there are something that are misinterpreted, perhaps there are things that need to be clarified, so there's that helps us to engage with our citizens to properly direct them to the right information, because it's social media, we can never tell which direction it's going to go, right? So we want to make sure that people have the right information for the conversation.
I can find out where the hottest trick-or-treating spots are in the city of Vancouver. it is actually kind of neat, because I started that survey, you have to probably consult with you to make sure that's as accurate as possible. But that I started that survey in 2009. We did it on the Big Dumb Architects web. That's my other app, other job. That really, we did that and did all the webs over the website and just kind of quietly tweeted it. And the 50 responses we had was somewhat disappointing. And then the fact is that it's not enough. And why I use that example is, then we teamed up with the city, with the Vancouver Sun. And so between the working with, that was when Chad Skelton was working with the Vancouver Sun, between working with partners, between working with both the paper as well as multiple avenues of, it's called Tweet and Treat. Get it? Tweet and Treat. But That's pretty much what happened in the staff meeting. That that it kind of evolved, and then we had 500. So the response actually was really interesting and kind of coming into that conversation. And then moving into really then the following year, as we just kind of just got better and better and kind of reaching out and getting information about, you know, where people were trick-or-treating and really how many there were. And then what's neat is actually the data set we created, you know, knowing all the limitations, in particular bias, and understanding that this data has a distinct bias to it, that we made sure we connected to other data sets to kind of see, does this correspond or correlate with other data sets, in this case the census. And what we did was we actually connected census, more importantly, census response, voting, civic voting, and there's one more, I can't remember the one, but between the three, between trick-or-treating, census response, and voting, we actually found that they all corresponded. It was actually kind of like, wow, right? Didn't expect that. And what that comes in is actually the story of how, you know, you connect data through silos. And really, when you do that kind of connection, you actually have very unique insights towards understanding that there's this area of, cultural facilities, that there is this unique area of super engagement, if you will. People who show up to vote, people who are great trick-or-treat providers, that there is that element of the city. And really, how does that affect city policy? Does that tell you that there is a certain relationship to density, which was, by the way, there was. You know, there is actually this unique trick-or-treating density sweet spot that you can't be too far, because trick-or-treaters are calculating, you know, the net return on, you know, doorstop to curb ratios, and then you can't get in the building in downtown Vancouver. And what was neat is actually seeing that body and then coming in towards thinking about neighborhoods, thinking about really is the idea that there is actually a certain density through which actually does provide a level of compactness, but then at the same time, a level of engagement that doesn't necessarily, it's not expressed in suburbanness, and neither is it expressed in really high densities. And that really, that's kind of how one data set folds in towards a deeper understanding in urban policy.
So I think there were a few other examples social media, yeah.
This question's for Linda. I'm curious the politics of the open data, and in that sense, because you mentioned that there's an inventory of, you know, a long list of data sets that the city generates, but who's driving what gets published or what gets made accessible? Understandably, that you're able to capture it within the reasonable amount of resources and what have you, but is there other factors at play in determining what gets put out as open data?
Yes, for sure. So it depends on the resource that is required to publish the particular data set. So there are things like we might have to go back to the legacy system, and it's really hard to publish the data in a machine readable format. Mm-hmm. So there are things that perhaps the data are captured in hard copy or paper copy, so we have to key into the system. That's just how it was collected. And trying to figure it out how to display it in a format that makes sense for people to use, and then also working with the business department to explain the data. That's always quite resource intensive, because there are times that we have systems that we just don't have documentation that has all the data definition. So I have to go back and find out who's the right person to talk to and how to get all the data.
But in terms of like deciding, so that's more kind of on the technical side of making, like generating the data,
right.
But in terms of, you know,
and
what gets collected, and like, so for example, if I'm a big developer in the city and I want a particular type of data, like, have I got the opportunity to influence that in some way, or is
yes.
Or is that, you know, how does that piece get navigated more on the user side as opposed to the technical side?
Right. So we get requests through the different channels, so I keep tab up to who's asking for what data, and I'm trying to get back to them. So the more requests that we get for a particular data set, that sits at a high priority. So when I go back to the business owner or to the higher senior management, and I can say there are a lot of people asking for this data set, and it's very important if you let me know how you're thinking of using that data, so people get their mind and say, like, oh, okay, or for what purposes. There are times that I just get emails and say, can I have this data? And that's the end of the email. So I'm like, okay, we'll do it. I can't even go back to that person and ask for details as to what you want in that data, because I can't just put out playground equipment data per se without knowing what will be useful. So, but then if we have to prioritize our resources for us to allocate the resource and meet the widest need, that will be the biggest priority.
And who decides what gets published? Like, where does it, at what level, or does it depend on the data set?
Depends on the data set, again, depends on the resource, and then if there is any heated council report that needed a certain information, if that can be published, then we'll get that out first. Of course, if council wanted a certain data set to put out, then that would get higher priority as well.
Coming back on this side, yeah, just a question for the entire panel. Do you think there's any relationship between the way data is collected today, the way we're socially networked, and short-term decision-making in the kind of political and economic urban environment? And I can give you a few examples that I think would suggest that it is contributing to short-term thinking and short-term decision-making compared to the way things were done before, let's say. Can I give a couple of examples?
Yeah.
So today in Vancouver,
yeah,
we spend an inordinate amount of time paying attention to homeowners on the west side. And I would argue that that situation was kind of hijacked a lot of what we should be, is a focus, an incorrect focus. So we have a lot of 17-year-old homeowners who have an inordinate amount of influence over the way housing is built in the lower neighborhood.
But then it's that chart I showed. Is that data or is it politics?
No, but it's about the questions that you ask, the questions you think are important. And I believe, we should get around those people.
But that's politics.
No, I know.
That's beyond data. That is the narrative you chart in terms of understanding politics.
Most data that is presented in the newspapers is been politicized.
It's all politicized. All knowledge is politics.
No, I understand that. But I think it's important. What's it about the questions that you ask?
I have a question just on that point. We talked about this earlier, but so Alberta, they have a regular practice of conducting censuses on an annual basis, right? To get more frequent data and all that other stuff. And I know that the city of Vancouver was talking about doing something like that for more up-to-date information and more relevant and representative data. Are there any, you know, has anyone ever explored doing that as well? Because it seems to be paying off quite nicely for Edmonton, Calgary, and those things.
I know the BC Stats is exploring really the idea of, actually it goes into the question of the short form, really how useful is the short form in terms of changing availabilities in terms of vital information, and how do you, this is the one that always kills me, how do you calculate immigrants versus emigration? Like that's, like, you know, it's pretty easy to guess when do people die and when are people born? And you guess that they age somewhere between that period. Like, that's a really interesting part of that. I know, me too. But really, that's an interesting part of the demographic equation. But that part of the equation is actually pretty solid. The one that kind of goes up and down is actually, that's really hard, is actually the immigration numbers. And what's interesting is actually over time, how we begin counting that now is actually through MSP. And actually now we're looking at people coming in and coming out of the MSP system as a proxy measure of that immigration. And so what's interesting is actually now this conversation is really, will BC Stats be given the resources to do that? Like, does, because you gotta understand, the provincial government, as an example, in 1994, for BC Stats budget was $2 million. Want to guess what the budget is for BC Stats in 2017? $2 million. And so really, what, how does that fit into that prioritization of data and information? And really, you know, that covers a couple of governments, but it also shows how, it's not necessarily government, but how sometimes power doesn't necessarily like transparent data, and really how it can muddle it through. But, you know, coming to this conversation, BC Stats does offer an annual up-to-date estimate in terms of population growth. I mean, funny enough, actually, I was just on the phone with CDC talking about the latest numbers coming out saying that the city of West Vancouver actually shrank by 2.3%. And I think that's, you know, the interesting thing is, okay, well, what happens when you find out that the city of West Vancouver shrinks by 2.3%?
And how accurate is this forecast of, you know, a million people by 2037 and all that?
Just to the first question, what is new city data? Where is city data heading in the future? I would like to argue that the Wikipedia pages that reference anything to do with Vancouver or Metro Vancouver is a type of infrastructure for the city. It's its own distinct data set. Where is city data heading into the future? It's where Wikipedia goes, and that content that's related to Vancouver, that infrastructure, is affected by Wikipedia's policies and whether it disappears or stays. If we were to design a Vancouver-specific Wikipedia, what would you like to have it from here, from this point, not a 10-year-old website?
Change that question. I think there's been some initiatives by some tech companies to go like, well, what if we build a city for the internet? Like, well, we're fundamentally rebooting a city for, and it's an interesting question for that. So what would that do? You wake up to a poll and touch it on your smartphone.
It's what we call pop-up polls, right? That's the most accurate way to call data.
I mean, what does the audience think? What does that rebooted city look like? Is it something full of noise? Is there a signal?
My question is, who controls the website? Is it the city? Is it the private company?
Right.
And then, so basically, it all comes down to how you want to display that data. Is it going to be political? Is it going to be biased? If it's going to be displayed by the city, it's most likely going to be unbiased. But if it's run by a private company, which is basically what we're kind of discussing, it's most likely going to be biased. So the question is, is the government or the city or any municipality, are they willing to basically pay? Or are they basically willing to compromise the cost of building an effective system of collecting that data and displaying that data for the cost? So what I mean is, basically it all comes down to who's collecting the data and how it's going to be displayed. If, for example, the budget of the city of Vancouver is $2 million and they're spending $1 million on collecting that data, basically, if a private company comes in and they say, we're gonna collect all that data for you for 10% of that, for about 10%, would you be willing to go with that private company?
I think what these points are connecting up to is the question of what rises to the top and what's prioritized when the city takes a decision, and it's still a selective process.
Yeah, the question is who selects it.
absolutely. It's who's making the selection is different, but it is still a selective process. And I think that's a common theme that people are starting to prod at. In the front row, yeah.
Yeah. Andy, you talked about water as an analogy. So the city provides water, goes through the pipes, comes to your house. You know what to do with it. You can cook, you can throw it on your lawn. With data, if you hand someone an XML file, they might not know what to do with it. So one of my questions is, this was a representation of the government providing infrastructure. So what would it look like if the government were to be an infomediary and to help people actually interpret this data and use it to solve the questions that they have?
Well, it understands actually an even earlier story is what we have, what we call schools, public education, literacy, right? That fundamentally the literacy that really, if you actually look at some of the early census, like you ever wondered why the school system and the education categories for the census are organized the way they are? There were quitting points of when you should stop your education. So there are some people who stopped at grade 4, some people stopped at grade 7, some people stopped at grade 12, etc. And really what that meant was an issue of literacy and how critical it was, or how the economy allows you to quit at a certain time, and really how much that's totally changed. And really part of this is actually part of that agenda that I'm talking about for the city program. It's really talking about the opportunity and actually the fundamental need towards increasing a data literacy, a quantitative literacy within the community, within Vancouver. That my job isn't just making sure that we hold these great global events, it's as an educator. That fundamentally, schools, universities offer a leadership position towards education. And I think that that's really part of the big challenges, because it's changing so fast, it has changed so fast. Really, how do we pass on that education?
One thing I would add to that too is I think you have to be really careful when you go in and you interpret data. You have to make sure you're going in a very unbiased fashion, that you don't have sort of the theory in your mind that you're trying to prove, because you can be very selective with data. And you can give data sets to two people and they can have completely different interpretations. And so you just have to be very cautious that you're not bringing in your own sort of biases and theories. So it is challenging. We have, I always say when we're hiring, there's so many people that technically are good researchers, but to teach a researcher how to really interpret the data and make it into that narrative that we talk about, to really give it some useful insights, it's a real skill, it's a real challenge, and that's usually your more senior researchers. It takes years for people to get to that stage where they're actually a good researcher.
Although I'm a firm believer that the transparency is the new objectivity, that in the world we live in, there's no any chance anyone claims that they're totally objective. It's not just and begin the conversation. One of the things that I find the most destructive element is actually how data is supposedly used to end discussions. That is toxic in a democracy. And fundamentally, when some people goes up and I'm slightly cautious. We're saying like, well, like if it's like you said, the plural of anecdote is not data. Well, that's trying to shut down people. That does not work in a healthy city. And that's the context through which data is situated.
Wendy's been waiting.
I have a question for Evie on all of the polling that gets done. And whether there's some public access to some of these, well, I guess some private polls, but or a place you can go and find, geez, did anyone do a poll question about this that I might have access to? Is there anything like that?
I would say 95% of our work is usually privately commissioned, so it's not accessible to the public. But there are some organizations like Pew Research Center in the States, Wealth of Information. There's some agencies here in Canada too that tend to, like in Vermont, for example, they do a lot of social market research. So there are certain organizations that are very generous with, and they may be also, I mean, just even governments, for example, too, on government websites, there's some there. But that's the challenge. Most of it is it's not at our disposal to.
There's an entrepreneurial idea for somebody to kind of, you know, a place where you gather in what polls are out there.
Yeah.
Well, Angus Reid's kind of gone now. They're publicly available, but how do you get them in one place?
Yeah.
And then, I would pay pay for access to the app that told me where the poll was.
Angus Reid's gone very much that route now to create the institute. He wanted to be kind of like the Canadian Pew Research Center, so he's doing a lot of research like that too. That's very accessible.
Duncan, then.
So, I mean, from a UI perspective, we're always interested in, you know, sort of what's happening in cities, where we're going, the dialogues around that. And so, you know, we talked a little about how you use data. You know, Andy showed some examples of what he's done, and there's sort of the different clients. But I'm wondering, maybe you can speak to, like, I know you do have not just political clients, but, you know, private sector clients, including Wendy and JBL. So what is it that people sometimes solicit from an urban perspective or city perspective? What do people solicit you for? Like, what are your clients looking for to go be the collector of that data, but also the distributor of that data?
Well, it's certainly in terms of sort of land use planning. I mean, we'll you know, and just so you know, too, we do hardly any political polling at all. But
research companies
will say that,
while.
Too. That's just kind of, that's more of a hobby. It's not really for
our
business. But we'll work with municipalities that are looking, you know, doing community plans. So it's really this way of really, you know, they'll have the different engagement tools, but also a lot of survey work is done to make sure that we're hearing from the sound majority in terms of how they want to see the community shaping. Like, for example, tonight we're doing focus groups down on Lansdowne. They're taking down the whole Lansdowne Mall to basically incorporate into part of the city center. So we really, you know, just want to talk to the neighbors, sort of, okay, how do you want to see the future of this area? You know, what kind of uses do you want? What are your priorities? What are your values? So that's what we do a lot with municipalities, with developers. It tends to be usually sort of three types of polls. One could be at the beginning of a project, just really see what is the demand, like West Van, for example, is the population shrunk? Well, there's hardly been any new build, and there's very little transition housing in West Van, so I'm not surprised that the population are starting to move to other municipalities now just to be able to have it somewhere to downsize. So we'll do work with municipal developers to see what is the community demand, what type of housing do they want, and then to do the selling to the council is a whole other type of polling too, to say, hey, the community supports this, you know, support this kind of development, there's a need for this type of housing, so they have to make that sort of political argument. And then there's sort of the polling around sort of communications too, what's, how do we communicate this project. So that's in kind of the sphere of land use planning, that's what a lot of our work is.
And do you find it's gotten more over the years?
It's partly because the communities are so vocal, much more local than they were in the past about what goes on in the community, what goes up. I mean, look at how, you know, all the buildings in Carisdale that were built, and I don't know what year they were now, to get one new building up there, it can be a real challenge. So the communities are just a lot more engaged. So there is a lot more research being done just to show, you know, that there is public support for a development. Right now in hot housing markets, it's not so much about sort of the style and the shape of buildings, because it seems like it's almost like developers can go where they want almost and it's going to get sold. But as soon as the market starts to slow down a little bit, then they start looking at that kind of survey work as well. You know, what kind of amenities that people want for a future home.
Just making a quick comment there about the political polling. I mean, that's the stuff that we read in the paper. And that's another thing people have talked about, is that there's some forms of data that rise to the top, and not necessarily the right ones, or the most important ones. So, you know, thinking about where it's coming from and what seal of approval it comes with, I think is part of how we need to think about being data consumers. Alex?
So, ethical questions there, the last one, privacy. Of data, I think, is basically my question would be is, at what point are we going to rethink the line between, you know, data that needs to be within the city realm that needs to be considered private and confidential and hard to access and accessible at all, and what should be publicly available? Concrete example, you know, inspired by Andy N's, you know, horrific nightmare-inducing map, right, of who's buying houses up in West Point Grey. But in my work right now as well, too, it's the same thing, property ownership, and that data is very next to impossible to get. You know, we can get all kinds of maps online of parcels and assessment values and whatnot, but that would be one of my concrete examples. You know, maybe that data shouldn't be considered as private as it's considered right now as confidential. as it is right now, that, you know, opening that data set up of, well, who owns what land and where, would be quite helpful in a lot of ways in revolutionary term research.
And on that data nightmare thing, that it depends on who you are. If you're an owner, it's a dream. And really, I think part of that conversation is actually different data cultures. Because you can get that information from the city, actually any American city. That data is readily available. You know, I was able to find out that 3/4 of the people who are buying in the new Trump Towers are in New York, are limited liability corporations. And that's open and free information in the United States. So it covers different ideas and different cultural ideas of data. And to be honest, it's the best way of putting it. Killing generations of Canadian data analysts. Yeah, that's the best way of putting it. It's pretty much what StatsCan has done up until recently. Because it was seen as pay for service. It was seen as you have to come up with a whole bunch of information. You have to pay a whole lot of money for a whole bunch of information that Canadians gave away freely. And that was how the business of the census worked. Conversely, if you look at the United States and how it fundamentally began with an open and free system through which they are constantly improving, constantly making sure that it's accurate, it's open, that you see where does the core of data culture in the world begin. Ironically, it's in the United States. We are just catching up to the generations of data analysts that have been lost in Canada simply because we decided to do a computer service. And by the way, it gets worse in Australia.
Your nightmare scenario method focuses on the single family site. Any thoughts on trying to map out the multi-family site? And how what such a map might look like?
It might be coming. I wouldn't make any declarations, but something might be looking. So it actually, there are some technical difficulties of actually mapping multi-family sites, and any GIS geeks out there? Carnality? Definition of carnality?
There's all sorts of problems with multi-family sites.
But what's the definition of carnality?
Carnality?
Yes.
Many to many domain.
Bingo.
Multiple ownership.
Exactly.
They're terrible because they're not sometimes classified as commercial, sometimes they're classified as residential. There are strata to individual ownership, which is the main one. They're apartments, we don't even know that sometimes. Multi-family suites, so say you have a building with 5 units, now you're putting another 4, that's not even found at all. It's tough to get. Single family is easy.
Welcome to my world. Get your $20 outside.
To the condos, I think the main issue is that variables aren't freely available when you need it to do anything useful, like size or number of bedrooms. So you can map where are buildings that have condos over $1 million, all these things that you need to do. Where you can map ranges of prices, or map how many there are per building and all these things, but it doesn't help you if you don't know how many bedrooms, for example, or what the size is. So,
5 years ago when Andy made that map, 2011, the $1 million mark was still relevant. There's still different reach of people working in the year. But now it's no longer relevant. No one locally here can afford it. There's no one things that you can afford. It's relevant to be helping back. So,
that's right. But, you know, we can do things like, you know, analysis. You can say, right, what's now the median condo cost of $500,000 line by a lot. It's now at about $600,000 in the city of Vancouver. But that doesn't help you. If you don't know what the median is it a two-bedroom? Like, if you want to say where are the condos that are still under 400,000, it doesn't help you. You want to know where the two-bedrooms are under 400,000. We don't have that yet. At least not freely available.
Something might be happening, but you know. But the fact of the matter is that it's details matter. Like anytime you see these declarations of thousands of units being put on the ground, well, what's the details? Is it a three-bedroom family-oriented unit? Is it a 450 square foot bachelor unit? So when we see these declarations of how many thousands of housing units are being put in any one place, details begin to matter. And I think that that's really part of that discussion, that you may have data available, open data, but then what are the details within that data and how useful is that? But I think when it comes in towards talking about multi families, I think, we're working on something. That's Aaron. I went to high school.
Yep.
So you talked about how the U.S. has a better culture of data sharing. I'm wondering for all the panelists. For example, Sweden, I think if you buy like a card, you can put all your information on that. You can use it at 7-Eleven to buy food. You can use it to tap into bus systems. And then you have another side of that. I guess like authoritarian governments, like Singapore, where maybe private information might be more easily accessible. I'm not sure. So can you, through you, talk about good data cultures outside of North America that you look to for inspiration?
Oh, it's an interesting challenge because one of the best sources of rental information, how much it actually costs to rent, isn't CMHC, it's Craigslist.
Yeah.
And Craigslist will not release their data set, even though you could be anybody and they won't release it.
They'll ban you too.
Yeah, they'll ban you if you create a scraper. Fuzzy Bear 75. But anyways, the fact of the matter is that we actually already have all these great bastions of data. But then the question is it going to be made open, or is everybody going after the master switch? Is everybody trying to declare a monopoly over a certain piece of information so that they can ultimately monetize it? And I think that's a really big question that I could possibly answer. But that's pretty much what the pattern is every time you offer a piece of information. That is there that type of reciprocity. And in part of that idea of the public good. I mean, part of this discussion of open data is actually this kind of commitment towards the public commons. That ideally is that is part of then this idea of need to plot as data as the new waters, and the idea that it is for public commons. When they created the water system in the 1800s, it wasn't the idea that only these people get water and the other people don't get water. It's the idea that everybody gets water.
But the internet has disrupted so many things. Yeah. Like Yellow Pages no longer exist. They used to be great places to get information, and I guess for a fee they provided Yellow Pages might be too free. But somebody has to change that screen.
And that is part of the great disruption, and what does it mean for information?
Any more reactions on that from the panel?
I would say for data culture, it's in the U.S. And the rural country, you can see a lot of the open data programs as they open by default and data first kind of strategy. So in the city of Vancouver, we're still moving that culture from data silos that the departments are protecting their data and making sure that like, I'm the custodian of the data, I want to make sure it's accurate and I want to make sure that I know how the data is being used and it's very much kind of micromanagement in a way for in terms of data. So if there is that culture of data sharing, so if we have data custodian for this particular data set, not across the different departments, so we know for sure for a reliable data source for this particular data, we'll go to this department. Not depends on who you know who have access to the data. So that everyone will have one single source of truth. So that would be very good. And we're trying to get to that direction.
No, it's a very different world for us actually. I mean we're governed by the PETA, so but we still have to ensure that we're talking data from the information does remain anonymous and confidential and it's not because the concern is always that it's gonna use for telemarketing. Purposes, and that's always the concern, is sort of how it's being used. Is it for the intended purpose for the common good, or is it being used for commercial purposes? So I think we all kind of work in different data gathering. We have different kind of oversights.
Yeah. I know for some of my data reasons, I always ask, so would you like A positive or B negative, right, in terms of the blood type I should sign that data use agreement? And that's how serious on privacy is, and it ought to be that way. And I think that is a difficult dialogue that's going to emerge. What's the right to my data?
So from my side, this has been great, and I've particularly appreciated the discussion and the framing of data as meaning a culture of data, expertise around data. an expert being someone who doesn't just follow the rules, but who actually knows when potentially they might be mended or violated, and who's not afraid of having an open conversation about the fact that all data is partial and selective and flawed and comes from particular interest to us. So hopefully this is a helpful stimulation around thinking about what it means to have a craft of data. I'm going to hand over to Duncan from the ULI to say a few closing words. Thanks so much.
I'll be really quick because it's the end of the day, but as Peter said, I'm an alumni of this program, and clearly that's done well. But I'm the Vice Chair of ULI, so I just want to thank everybody for coming. Thanks for our three speakers. And others, I think, came out from Peter and I continuing our conversation, because ULI, we're all about, you know, it's an education, for those of you who don't know, it's education, research-based, not-for-profit, focused on dialogue solutions, if you didn't see the tagline at the bottom. So we're just interested in convening conversations about cities. It's across the globe. Our fastest growing is in Asia. It's based out of America. We've got chapters all across Canada. So we're always interested in convening different conversations about how data is impacting cities, having small roundtables about even down to the neighborhood level, and major events around thought leadership. So if you're not a member, I hope you'll consider joining. Talk to me, you can talk to Shannon, or you can email us, or follow us on the website. You obviously heard something, because somehow you made it here. And if you're looking for a graduate program, I mean, Peter's right here. There's lots of alumni here and students here, so it must be good. But thanks very much, and we'll hope to see you at a future event.
Fill your survey forms.
Oh, the survey, yeah. Thank you. You should have handed it to us.